Hey friends, we are Amber and Garrette Baird with Eyenamics, and we are cinematic wedding filmmakers.
And part of what we love about using the Sony system to shoot our films with is the ability to use 4K internally in our cameras. This gives us huge latitude in post and also gives us that ultra high definition that we absolutely love.
In this video, you will learn about
the advantages of shooting in 4K,
key features of Sony cameras and lenses,
how to create a strong wedding film intro.
Another thing you will learn about is using time shift between the past and present to help tell your story.
How to introduce characters in your video, such as the bride, groom, and their family.
Using the high dynamic range of Sony cameras for color grading.
You'll also learn about using multiple cameras and different focal lengths for a variety of shots.
Being culturally aware for significant moments in a wedding day.
Using music to create powerful moments.
Let's take a look at one of our recent 4K wedding films, and then we will meet you back in our editing suite so we can start breaking it down for you.
On our first date, we grabbed each other's hands and made a very early commitment to one another to give this relationship a shot, a real shot. I'm so fortunate to be holding your hands right now here at our wedding, a real wedding, to make a lifetime commitment to you with our family, friends, and all these wonderful strangers too here as our witnesses. No one has been able to portal into my brain the way you do. I've been searching for a true life partner,
and I'm so thankful to have found you, the right woman. You understand me and my crazy ways. I love that you not only accept me for who I am, but you embrace, encourage, and support me the way you do, with all your heart.
Absolutely thrilled that you had such good sense to choose each other as life partners. And also, what I'm sure everyone has seen is that they have this sort of cha-cha-cha chemistry with each other, which we absolutely love to watch. It's really all about what sort of the movies and the songs and the books talk about.
Michael, from the moment I got out of that cab and kissed you before our first date even began, I know you were the one for me. You're my Besharet, my puzzle piece. You're my best friend and my rock. I'm so happy and so grateful that we are partners in this journey that we call life. We are connected on this magical level that they talk about in the movies. I promise to support you, to push you, inspire you, and love you. And today, my soul is complete.
Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, v'gam b'ruach shel ahava. Blessed be you who come here not only in the name of the Lord, but in the spirit of love itself. Mi adir al hakol, mi baruch al hakol, mi gadol al hakol, hu yorech hechatan v'hakala. May he who is supreme in power, blessing and glory, bless his bridegroom. Together you should be forevermore. You should be together amidst the white wings of eternity, and you shall be together even in the silent memory of God. love one another, a bond of love, let it be a moving sea between the shores of your souls. As the future may hold on toward storms, so too are there uncounted good times. Face them with the understanding that out of resolve conflict grows harmony and love, and from giving without measure the wondrous joy of shalom, of a sense of peace. As boundless as the sea, my love is deep. The more I give to thee, the more I have, for both are infinite. It is indeed in the act of giving that you receive more than you could ever imagine.
The thing I love the most about you is the way you wear your heart on your sleeve and put forth your heart in everything you do. You have improved my life in so many wonderful ways and bring out the best in me. Thank you, Jenny. I love you so much, my boo-boo bear.
And back to my lady I held every night. It's a long, hard road trying to get home. I've been gone now for too long. I'm not trying to stop.
So a couple months before WPPI, Sony called us and asked us if we'd be interested in filming like a little highlight of their Sony. They were going to have some kind of a nice party or something. Like, yeah, that sounds really cool. We loved the opportunity. I think we absolutely killed it. We came away with some shots that I'm very proud of, and I would put it up against any other ceremony I ever shot.
On our first date, we grabbed each other's hands and made a very early commitment to one another to give this relationship a shot.
So we always like to have our films have a logo on it. And a lot of the times, actually all the time, I will start the music just about halfway through the logo, just so that we can start just rolling it into the film. Then we cut to a roof shot of the ceremony itself. Now, for this shot, we had to find the right person to give us access to the locked door that led us up on the roof so we could have this big wide shot. Originally, I had put this camera on a tall tripod in the back of the room, but I'm glad I decided to do this because the back of the room looked like this, and that shot would have been unusable because we would have been shooting over the backs of the heads. Having 600 photographers there was a huge part of the ceremony, so I didn't dwell on it a lot, but I just wanted to show people that, hey, look at all these people here. These are all, majority of them are professional wedding photographers and filmmakers, and they're all trying to shoot the wedding. So that was part of the story I really wanted to put out there. During all this, the vows have started, and then these clips last just second or two. Then we go to a tight shot of the groom reading his vows.
I made a very early commitment to one another to give this relationship a shot.
Now, his vows were a huge part of this edit, and as were hers, but I really wanted to start with that and to establish, you know, who the groom is, because if I started with just makeup and prep with the bride and then prep with the groom, you really don't know who they are until they get ready and do the first look or something like that. So we started with the groom doing his vows, and then cut to reactions from his mother and father, specifically her. She had just a really, really cute look on her face. She was really getting into it and enjoying it. We want to see the family enjoying the moment with them. One of the challenges that day was to find the nice wide shots without getting a lot of photographers. It's a nice little slider shot that kind of moves forwards and tilts up a little bit. You did a really good job of that.
I'm so fortunate to be holding your hands right now here at our wedding. A real
wedding. And of course we want to see the bride's reaction right to the groom's amazing vows. So that's just part of the way we shoot wedding ceremonies.
This camera here, that was with the A7S II. And with a 10 to 18, and now the 10 to 18 is a cropped lens. When you're shooting 4K on the Sony A7S II, and you have a cropped lens, you put the clear image zoom on 1.4, and it works beautifully. So that's where I can get those really, really big wide shots. And for these tight shots, these were on the 70-200. Both Amber and I were both on a 70-200. And I think occasionally we did use the clear image zoom just to punch in just a little bit more to be able to see a little tighter. Cut back to the groom saying his vows. Now this angle, I'm at the same focal length as I was before, but here I'm not using clear image zoom, and here to punch in a little tighter, I use clear image zoom. So I think I may have been at 2x clear image zoom just to really get his emotions in his face as he's reading his vows to his soon-to-be wife.
With our family, friends, and all these wonderful strangers too here as our witnesses.
Now here's where we start the time shift process. Cutting from him saying his vows, we do a little short time lapse. I usually set the camera up and just let it roll for about 15 minutes video.
This clip was a transition clip from the ceremony to back to the groom prep, and you merged the audio so that we could transition from the ceremony to the groom prep, because you always kind of want those transitional clips so it's not so abrupt. So you just walked into him typing his vows out, right on the morning of the wedding.
Yep, and I was like, stop what you were doing. And he'd already done some of them, but he was going through them.
I've been searching for a true life partner.
And I'm so thankful to have found you, the right woman. You understand me and my crazy ways.
This is the point where we merged the two audio sources together. So we went from ceremony vows, and then they slowly merged into him actually saying them that morning, which really helped with the time shifting application to where it made sense to go from point A to point B without being too abrupt. I think that was a really nice, smooth transition.
These clips graded so well because that room is green.
Right.
That room is green, and you were able to pull out skin tones, and you weren't getting as much
Yeah, that's before I graded it, and it's after.
So
you can see like we shot it flat, but you can see the green from the wall is on your face, and I was able to pull those out, add some reds, and really help the skin tone out quite a bit. And that's one thing I love about shooting with the XAVCS format is it's easy to grade.
I love that you not only accept me for who I am, but you embrace, encourage, and support me the way you do, with all your heart.
When I asked him to read his vows out loud after he had just typed them, you know, the vows to his soon-to-be wife, probably the most intimate words he's ever composed. So he eagerly said yes, because he trusted me as his wedding filmmaker that was the right decision for his final product. And I just really like the way, just a big deep breath, the weight of the day coming down on him and him feeling it. That was a really nice moment to capture. And then we cut to another transitional shot. I love using aerials. I try to use them very sparingly, one or two per highlight. This kind of is a character in itself too, because it could rain at any moment, and we were feeling that pressure all day long. It could, like, any second it could rain, but we were so fortunate and it did not. But this is a case where I've used the same clip twice, and just use the tail end of it to use it as a transitional piece to go to the bride prep and these pretty shoes.
My go-to lens for the bride prep portion of the day is the Sony 28-135. I love it for its wide range, so that I'm not switching out lenses throughout the day and possibly missing things, you know, key moments that'll happen, because sometimes the moments sneak up on you. So you can, you know, stand in the back room and get the wide of the 28 and then get a tight shot at the 135, or even use the clear image zoom to get even closer. We're only gonna stay on those little details very quickly, because right. We're looking for the natural reactions of, you know, the bride with her adorable mother, and we're loving the smiles in the next clip.
Yes.
And loving the smiles and the interaction that's right there. I think the mom had requested the photographer take a photo, and it was just so sweet. So then we're gonna go back and forth with the bride prep and groom prep so that it doesn't get boring.
Right.
The main goal is don't want it to get boring or seem like it's dragging. So then you're going to go back to where the guys are getting ready.
Right. We've established the guys are getting ready. We've established that they're at a separate location than the girls. So now that we have both of those ideas established, we can jump back and forth without confusing the viewer too much. And then we're going to transition with the guys. They're done. We want a kind of a cool shot of all the guys walking. So I like doing like a wide shot of them walking down. This hallway was beautiful. You get the mirror there, and so we just, you know, cut that, and then them walking over the camera.
So then this next clip with the bride, the makeup artist, she already knew the best place to position the bride was in front of the window. So of course, I didn't have to ask them to move any or change anything. I did have them shut off some lights in the room that were making really weird mixed lighting. But so the bride is seated in a makeup chair, but I still want to get up high, so I'm shooting, you know, pretty high angle, and with the A7S II, I'm able to tilt the screen down to make sure I'm in focus and framed correctly. Just getting those super flattering, beautiful shots. As every woman knows, the best selfie is from up high. So on the wedding day, when I'm shooting the bride, the most beautiful way to shoot her is from up high while she's in the makeup chair. It just is a very flattering and a beautiful angle for them. So I'm pretty tall. I'm a pretty tall woman, but I still want to get even taller. If she's in a tall chair, I want to get even taller so I can flip the screen down and still be able to frame up my shot, make sure I'm in focus, make sure I get the shot. That's just one feature that I absolutely love about the camera. It seems simple, it seems maybe even a little silly for some. Just being able to tilt it up and down, it just makes our job so much easier.
During this whole time, we have music playing in the background, and we've cut away from the vows just for a moment, just to let the video breathe a little bit and show what's going on.
And then this is a case of where you do anything to get the shot. I was like inside the closet.
She was inside a closet
to get the shot. Yes, because I just wanted a totally different angle, and sometimes hotels rooms are very restrictive of space. Mm-hmm. So you just have to do whatever you gotta do. we're always looking for interesting angles and use of negative space, but we also want to keep each shot fresh. So that's why we're always changing our focal distance.
We want the viewer not to work hard to watch the film, but we don't want to shoot like everything on 35 millimeter. We don't want to shoot everything even on 80 millimeter. We want to shoot, you know, like she loves the 28 to 135. So she'll 28. And then I think our next shot is going to be a little closer. Yeah, probably 135 of people watching her getting ready and smiling and enjoying the day. We don't want the film to be static and boring. Like, we don't want everything to be from the same focal length.
After the, you know, the clip of the ladies watching, we have just a few really beautiful, we call them like beauty shots of the bride. So like, she's still doing makeup, but you know, we're looking for the most beautiful angles. And
this shot, I think, is my favorite bridal prep shot of any film we've ever done. That Amber nailed it. But here's one thing that made this shot great, is that the angle is just a little higher. And so it really is flattering for the bride. This is just the window light. And for whatever reason, it's just curving around her face, really, really making her cheeks pop. It's a beautifully composed and beautifully lit. And it's one of my favorite shots.
No matter how beautiful the bride is or how handsome the groom is, we're always looking to get their best angle, their best features.
So then we go into, it's a little bit of time shifting back to the night before, which is the rehearsal dinner we attended.
We did attend the rehearsal dinner to make sure that we got more natural audio, because you're never really quite sure how the vows are gonna end up.
That you had such good sense to choose each other as life partners.
And then we just cut to a quick reaction of the bride and groom. This is the power of the codec and the 4K that comes out of this. Now, for whatever reason, I'm not gonna point any fingers, but this was greatly underexposed. This is the shot that came out of the camera. So that's what I came home with.
Don't show my...
I'm just saying, I don't know how it happened, I don't know why, but it's greatly underexposed. I mean, if I would have been on my other camera system, if I would have tried to bring those shadows up, I would have got so noisy. But we're able to come
back
to something.
Here's the one
thing
I want to tell everyone. We shoot so many weddings, there's no way you can get every single shot perfect. Every single time. Right. You're human. Occasionally, something weird will happen. I don't even know what happened to that shot. But you're not perfect. You're not going to get every single shot exposed perfectly, framed perfectly. The power of the Sony cameras and the codec is that you can recover. Right. You can recover that.
And I was able to recover it without blowing out his hair light. Again, we couldn't stop the toast and say, okay, we got to reset our lights. We just rolled with it, and I think it worked out really well. So during her toast, we're cutting back to him finishing up getting ready. I mean, the amount of detail is just ridiculous on his hair on his face is just, I don't know, it's just ridiculous, the detail we come home with. This is a scenario where shallow depth of field works, because out the window behind him is a car parking lot. I don't want to see that. I want to see, you know, this bow tie and his friend helping him. This is an interesting shot. This is A7S II with a 10-18 clear image zoom is at 1.4 crop handheld. And anytime I want to do a moving shot, I want to call it faking a slider shot. I just pull the camera into my body and move my body left and right. I don't want to break the moment. I just want to get the shot and not have to say, wait a second, let me get a tripod. Wait a second, let me get my slider. Wait a second, let me put it together. Wait a second, let me mount my camera. And action. I just wanted to get it. I mean, if I come into the room and I got a tripod and I got a slider and I got a glide cam and I got shotgun mics and I'm here to put a mic on, it's really, he's very aware that he's being filmed, and a lot of times the guys especially will act much differently once they are in the scenario where, hey, I'm being filmed, you know, all this crazy lighting going on. So we like to keep our kit small, go in there with handheld, and with that built-in image stabilization, it really helps us get the shot without being too intrusive. That's one thing I love about the A7S II, five-axis stabilizations. You can get handheld shots. And yes, this is a wide shot, so your wider lenses are going to be much more forgiving when you go handheld, but it still gives you the same effect without having to get set up. And under all this, of course, his mother's talking, and we just cut back every once in a while just to remind him what they look like and how cute they are. And then I walked in, and Michael, our groom, was writing a note to be delivered to his bride during prep. Again, handheld, you know, grab the camera.
It's really all about what sort of the movies and the songs and the books talk about.
So this is one of the instances where we place the bride where we want her, to where there's beautiful light and beautiful natural light, and just let her then get ready. So we put her in a beautiful situation so that she can just get ready naturally, because brides and grooms or couples are non-actors. So you right. have to just allow things to happen organically. I mean, we may tell her, like, just twist your body just slightly more into the light, but then, okay, then now just get ready like you normally would. We put her in a situation to make her look amazing, right. and we can get the shot that we need.
For those of you who think that you can only get a shallow depth of field with a 1.4 or 1.8 lens, this lens that we used for the shot here was the Sony 28-135. And you can see with the mom standing right behind her, you can see this nice bokeh at f4. At f4, when you're zoomed in a little bit, you're gonna get a nice little blur in the background that's gonna make your foreground pop. One of the things I love about Sony's 28-135 is that it's a parafocal lens. So this means you're setting up a shot, you have the bride and groom outside, you zoom all the way in, get your focus, and once you've got that focus zoomed all the way in, anything you do from 135 to all the way back to 28 is going to be in focus.
And then the next clip is when we're anticipating whenever things will happen. So the bride just got dressed. She has her final look, and that's always a part of the day whenever things get emotional. So here she is with her maid of honor. Maid of honor's crying, you know, we know that there's gonna be hugs, there's gonna be tears, there's gonna be smile and laughter. So you're always just on the lookout for those types of moments. We're looking for, like, look, this beautiful smile. She's thinking about, what is she thinking about here? Something, like, she's thinking about her groom, her, you know, spending the rest of her life with him. Right. So that's what we're looking for with those type of beauty shots.
What works for us is to wait till the bride's putting it on, wait till it's on her, and then, like, another shallow depth of field shot, I'm focused on the earring, and so you can see, that's probably the only time during the day you're going to be able to see that earring. I think that is more of a fun shot than just it's sitting on top of a table. One thing we have to keep in mind as filmmakers and also photographers at the same time is that, yes, you need to get your shot, but this is the most intimate moment of their life, and they're sharing it with their family.
It's very intimate, and, you know, they're letting us be a part of such a special day for them, and they're surrounded by their close family and friends, some of whom they probably don't see very often. So we're gonna back off and let them enjoy it. Yeah. Let it happen. Let these reactions happen naturally.
Michael, from the moment I got out of that cab and kissed you,
I really wanted to put some of her vows in there, because they went hand in hand with some of the things that her mother-in-law was saying. So we cut back, time shifting again, back to the ceremony. And then again, her mom and dad just watching it. She's just ecstatic with joy. And so I really wanted to show the reaction again of the family to what was going on. And not only their reaction, but also that reaction. I think she was talking about where they kissed on their first date. I thought that was a perfect time to show them having their first look for the very first time. This is downtown Las Vegas. We found this beautiful mural on the wall that just worked out perfectly. So for this shot here, we had three cameras running, and one of the cameras was a 10-18. It was a low shot on a slider, showing the whole mural and the two of them. However, it was a great eye candy shot. It was beautiful, but there was so much emotion going on during the first look. I mean, you don't want to cut that. You don't want to cut
their faces.
You know, look at her. She's on the edge of just tears. And look at him. I mean, I'm not cutting that just to put in a wide eye candy shot.
I'm so happy and so grateful that we are partners in this journey that we call life. We are connected on this magical level that they talk about in the movies.
This is a 70-200, this is a 70-200, this is a 70-200. So we put this in there just kind of clear your palate, so to speak.
To break it up.
Right.
Mm-hmm. To push you inspire you, and love you. And today my soul is complete.
We go back, she's wrapping up her vows, and she said something that was just, well, you saw in the video, just very powerful. And then it just broke him inside. I mean, just so sweet. Yeah. We hit a big moment in the audio track.
A crescendo.
And so a lot of times I'll use a eye candy shot, like a big glide cam. In this case, it happened to be an aerial shot of that mural. So I was still able to work that mural into that big wide shot, but with a totally different camera. And this, we go from this clip, which is dusk, daytime, and then our next time we see the bride and groom, boom, it's nighttime. Now, if I would have just cut to that, it would have been a little, it would have brought you out, at least for me it would. It would have brought me out of the film. And so by having that that transition like that, we're like, okay, it's daytime, and it's cloudy, just like it was the day of the wedding, and then it's nighttime. Okay, so then when you see nighttime, you understand that it's nighttime.
Because time had elapsed. We wanted to take the bride and groom out and get some fun Vegas-y video clips and photos, and it was totally nighttime. And so with the A7S II, of course, it didn't have a problem with the night shooting. As far as direction goes with these things, I mean, of course, the walking shots, we tell them, okay, just hold hands and walk across the street, and maybe, you know, like halfway through kiss, put your foreheads together, or
cuddle
yeah. or something like that.
But simple, with this, very simple directions.
But like with Vegas, even though they're a very romantic couple, this area isn't super uber romantic. So, you know, do something, just have a little dance or something like that. And they're of course played up to it, but you have to read your couple.
You have to read your couple and feel their energy, and their energy was just exploding all over the place. So they were like, yeah, let's do that.
Yes.
So they got out there, did some dancing, walked across the street, and it was really nice.
Yeah. Now we're actually getting into some of the ceremonial stuff.
We shot this video, it was a Sony event, but we shot it just like it was any other wedding. Like, for as far as we know, this highlight that we gave them is the only film that they have of their wedding. So we wanted to make sure that we included some of the most important parts, not just for Sony, but also for the couple. So they have a beautiful story to be told of the events that happened at their wedding.
Whenever you're shooting wedding films, you have to be very culturally aware of different people's religions and different significant portions of the wedding day. So like for Jewish weddings, the ketubah signing is one of the most important events of the whole day. So you want to make sure you capture that and also represent it on their wedding film. It's such a beautiful, like they had such a very unique and beautiful ketubah that you just, you know, it was really cool and fun to kind of capture too with the colors, and it's just gorgeous.
Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, v'gam b'ruach shel ahava. Blessed be you who come here not only in the name of the Lord, but in the spirit of love itself.
And then, of course, like the parents are taking it very seriously and, you know,
listening to what the rabbi is saying.
Yes, enjoying
talking
it.
Talking about family, yeah.
This room was a very tough room to shoot in. Not only was it pretty low lit and kind of cramped and small, but then you also had the chandelier hanging that was casting some shadows, which we just kind of had to live with that.
If we did not have the A7S II, if we didn't have that camera, it would have been just not been able to got that shot because it was so incredibly dark over there.
If you were wanting to try to light that certain situation, that would draw the family members out of the moment.
Blessed be you who come here not only in the name of the Lord, but in the spirit of love itself.
The A7S II is such a low-light beast that even though this is not ideal situation and it's fairly low lit, it's a low lit room, you can bump your ISO up, but we don't have to go as high because the camera
performs better at lower ISOs.
Yes.
On the A7S II, we may have shot this at, let's say, ISO 800, to whereas another system, you'd have probably been at 5,000. We've done tests, one camera system against the A7S II, and the A7S II every time shoots so much better at a lower ISO, so the image is actually cleaner. So one of the reasons why we love the A7S II is because of its low light performance. It is a low light beast, but not just low light, it has a broad dynamic range. So I was able to bring up the shadows just a little bit so that we still maintain, even though there are shadows underneath his eyes, we can still see his eyes, and it's not just this raccoon blacked out under their eyes. This is the raw image. This is the uncolored, ungraded image. And you can see his shirt is still, talking about dynamic range, his shirt is still, you can still see the details, still see the wrinkles, and also under his eyes where it's the darkest part of the room, even back here, the detail is still there and you can still see it. Whereas some camera systems, you would have to choose between, do you want to see the detail in his shirt or do you want to see underneath his eyes? You can't have both. And with Sony, in the large dynamic range, you're able to pull out both.
Together you should be forevermore. You should be together amidst the white wings of eternity.
Now for this next shot, I slowed it down. I don't use slow motion a lot, and when I do, it's very minimal. This is slowed down to 80% instead of 100. So it's a little slower, but it's not incredibly slower. It's not like slow motion or anything, just a little bit. And one reason why I did that for this clip is because this is a huge moment. She signed the ketubah, and I really wanted to emphasize the gravity of what she's doing. And she signs the ketubah, and then everybody puts their hands on it and they have a prayer. Then hugs all around, everybody's happy. And then we cut to people entering and coming in for the ceremony.
The guests haven't seen us all day. They've not been around us, so they're not used to videographer or filmmakers being around. So we're on 7200, so we're going to be able to capture their natural reactions, their smiles, their laughs, mm-hmm. hugging each other, just getting ready for a fun moment.
And nobody in this shot here made it, I don't think, in any other part of the film. But because we were shooting the pre-ceremony stuff, the couple, the family have a record of people enjoying their ceremony and seeing who was there, taking pictures. Now this next clip is just some little decorations they had there. I just use it as a transitional piece to go from this, and we're just going to fade over to the groom walking down the aisle with his mom and dad. Very tight aisle. Usually when you're shooting reactions, I focus on the front 2 to 3 rows, because that's where the family is going to be at. That's where grandma and grandpa, aunts and uncles, the major players of your film are going to be at. Now, this is one reason why I like to start with my audio first, because the audio down here, right about here, it hits with a big crescendo. And of course, what do I want to do with that big crescendo? I want to use it and utilize it and make it a moment. Another reason why I like 4K is because when I wanted it to kind of just slowly push in, just to show, just to give you a better look and just to emphasize, you know, the groom and what he's feeling at that moment. Even though if you're not delivering in 4K, if your client says, I don't want that yet, just give me 1080, that's fine. You still have more versatility when you're editing to be able to crop in to your image. If you like your second shooters, maybe somebody isn't framed right, or maybe you just have an editing decision that you would, like it's framed the way, it's framed nice, but you want it over here. You want to zoom in 200%, pop that guy's face over here and just to reframe it. It's absolutely great for that. And then right as the crescendo hits, guess who walks down the aisle? Boom. And as you can see, photographers. but you know what? We got the shot. It's really got that moment, her walking down the aisle. And then the groom says, I love you. Now,
on the verge of tears there,
on
too.
On the verge of tears, aww. Yes. So right as right after he says, I love you, the music drops down and it goes back into
the rabbi
talking, which he was talking through the entire ketubah signing as well.
Give to thee the more I have, for both are infinite. It is indeed in the act of giving.
Like this shot, was handheld, again with a 10 to 18, which is stabilized A7S2, 5-axis, kind of just like pushing through the crowd a little bit. And then we cut to mom, which just breaks down.
And her dad.
And then this music, when I first heard it, I knew it was just a powerful moment.
The more I have for both our infant, it is indeed in the act of giving that you receive more than you could ever imagine.
This is probably one of the most powerful crescendos of any song I've ever used. And so I wanted to force emotion down the throat of the viewer. And the first time I put these clips in the order and then press play and watch it go bump, 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 seriously, tear. It got me, it really got. And so when that happens, I know, yep, this is it.
These aren't just random clips from anything.
These are powerful clips. You know, this first clip, the symbolism, what's going on here. The second clip, he is just overjoyed, throwing his hands up in the air, and they're yelling, they're clapping over here. The next clip, mom and dad are clapping, showing great emotion. And then we show all the photographers trying to get the shot of what's going on. Then we cut to a wide shot, everybody clapping, and then boom, mom and dad are kissing. Yeah, we want that in there. And then we do a slider showing once again where we're at.
I anticipated that in Jewish ceremonies, they break a glass at the end of the ceremony. So I knew that was going to happen. So I made sure, like, whenever I saw the bag with the glass in it, I made sure to focus on that.
Amber knows when I'm in the back, I'm usually, for the part of the ceremony where they're kissing and being announced, I'm normally head to toe. And she already knows that's how I shoot. So she knows I have that shot. She knows I have a wide shot locked down in the back. So we're covered on all aspects of it. So she goes in really tight, knowing nobody else has this shot, to really focus on the symbolism of what's going on. And during the ceremony, we have some sign languages that we do, where I'll look at her, she'll look at me, and she'll say, like, I got a 2-shot or I got a 3-shot.
For the ceremony, you want several different focal lengths as well. That's right. One reason why we have like our wide shot in the back, so yeah. You can cut to that. You want to reset the brain and be like, oh yeah, remember, this is exactly where we are again. This is where we are. This is what's going on. And you want to give the viewer's brain a little bit of a break from just the couple 70 to 200s that you have.
Yeah, and you know, if you're in a big, ginormous, beautiful Catholic church, or maybe you're at some venue which is a garden center, you don't want every shot to be tight. So a lot of the times we'll have a 10 millimeter in the back, and on occasion I've used the Sony action cam and put it on top of our lockdown shot just to give us an overall view of the entire area and how beautiful it is. And so we can cut between that, and like you said, resets their brain, lets them see once again where they're at. Now for this kiss shot, this is interesting. We delivered in 1080 for this. And this is the actual shot. Now, I don't know why this gentleman decided to do it, but this is not a sanctioned photographer for the wedding. This is somebody that was there just to have a good time and take pictures. And in every one of our shots, he got up on stage, moved the curtain back, and it was a good shot, but not as good as the one we got. But it was kind of annoying, so I didn't want to focus people to focus on him as much. So for this shot here, this is actually zoomed in to about 200%. I think it's 180. And you can sort of see him over there, but that's one of the good things about shooting with 4K. Since we were delivering in 1080, I was able to just go in, cut him out, get the really great kiss shot, and then go back to the big, wide, euphoric moment. And under all that, of course, you heard the rabbi was talking, and some really, really good things to say. And so here we kind of fade to black, and we go from this really high moment of high energy, and it just, it's like a roller coaster, just goes straight down, and it goes to a much softer moment. Now earlier on, he was, you know, typing his vows and using his laptop. And so this is, talk about negative space, this is a black clip with nothing, no visual at all. It's just a long black clip for a little bit. But during that black clip, we have the sound of his laptop typing. And it really kind of, again, resets your brain. And you hear that typing. It's okay, what's that? Oh, he's doing his vows. So then we cut to this shot. which is another transitional shot, and we're going back to the beginning of the day. Boom, we're back to the beginning of the day, where he's going through his vows. And we're actually cutting back to the audio of his vows that we haven't used yet. These are vows you've never heard before. And then we fade back to the photo session a little bit.
Where they're being uber romantic.
Where they're being very romantic. The things he's saying are very romantic.
And then their first dance.
And then their first dance, which actually started the party. But what the viewer, if you weren't there, to the viewer, that was the dance. And then, of course, his vows are still being spoken. And then right as he says his last vows, we end the scene.
Everything you do. You have improved my life in so many wonderful ways and bring out the best in me. Thank you, Jenny. I love you so much, my boo-boo bear.
This is actually our laptop. It's the same laptop, but I was able just to set it up in the hotel room and just get this little B-roll shot to show the completion of that part of the story. People think it's over, fade to black, show the Alpha logo, and just as they reach up to the mouse to stop it, to view something else, the Alpha logo starts going crazy. We introduce some new fun music, maybe a little tiger growl in the background, and show our badass groom walking down the middle of Vegas. That was captured in 1080 at 120 frames per second with the A7S II. With the new Sony cameras and bodies, we're able to condense our kit, get our kit much smaller. So I was using a handheld, smaller gimbal with the A7S II on it. And then we just transitioned to a great party. One of the things we love to do, we love to keep a good balance in our films between, you know, we really don't want everything in slow motion with soft music in the background and vows underneath it. There is a time and place for that, but the wedding is more than that. The wedding is a celebration, and we really want to go out with a bang, so to speak, and show the wedding party and the friends and family, everybody just having a good time celebrating at the reception. And then the cake cutting time came. We went inside, and it's so dark in there. It's almost no light. And then there's just a little bit of LED light coming up from underneath the cake. And because we were using the Sony A7S II, we were able to capture that with no problem whatsoever. And one of the reasons why it captures light so well is it's only 12 megapixels. And because it's only 12 megapixels on a full frame sensor, those photocells are much bigger and can just, I mean, it's just physics. All the light it can gather is just phenomenal. It's the best low light performing camera I've ever used. It makes our lives easier.
And that also lends to the dynamic range as well. So you, with the larger photocells, you can get a broader dynamic range.
Some of our peers have said, well, I don't need a low light camera because I know how to light a reception dance floor. I know how I bring in my lights and I do 3-point lighting. I got a catch light, I got a hair light, I got a key light, I got all this stuff. And that's great for the dance floor. But if anything happens off the dance floor, you're struggling and scrambling to try to get that light moved to face other things. For instance, the cake cutting. I'm not trying to stop. For the reception, usually at the open dancing, the free dance, we only cover that with one camera. What I will do every once in a while, when stuff goes crazy and you hear just a big uproar of jubilation, you know something big's going down, I will grab the 10 to 18. For the most part, we almost always shoot it with an 85. I just like the way it looks, and we'll get some tight shots, and then we'll walk back and get a wider shots. Still with 85, just walked back a little bit to get a wide shot of everybody.
They had a band at this one, so we just got a couple clips of the band just to, you know, show that they were there. The bride and groom just jamming out. Look at that. Our job was done, and we were finally able to celebrate alongside the couple and their family and friends that night. And we had a good time. Yep. We really did.
I love it when mom and dad just get in on the celebration, get out there on the dance floor, and just forget about what's going to happen tomorrow or what's going to happen a week ago, and they just cut loose and just dance like nobody's watching. I love that. Now, this is an interesting clip. This is my secret sauce that we've done this for years, ever since we've shot with a smaller form factor camera. I love putting the camera on a 10 millimeter on the floor when the girls are wearing very long dresses. You can't do this when the short skirts, obviously. But putting it on the floor and telling everybody to dance around it, and it's fun. The guests just
they're already in a dance circle anyway.
They were already in a dance circle, so they were able to. She played into the camera. That was funny. Then she picked it up for some reason, and I just thought it was a very interesting shot. So I used it.
You're always looking for those interesting shots. Whoa. The groom having an amazing time. Oh my gosh, he's singing something.
Invited Elvis?
Other than that, from this point on, it's basically just getting different angles and different types of shots of the dance floor. Is that a gimbal shot?
No,
or is that
this
handheld?
Is handheld. All the wide shots at the reception party, dance party, were all handheld.
Being culturally aware, we know that this is going to be coming, so we make sure we have a couple different angles of it. And at this point in the song, it changes drastically. It sounds different.
Yep.
So we wanted to set the horror apart. It has a totally different sound. It's like a bridge.
You can see where it breaks down right here.
So during the bridge, we wanted to make sure we focus on the horror, since it is also kind of a more culturally significant portion of the day.
And I choose to go handheld a lot during the dance party because it has a very organic feel. You're in an action-oriented environment, and so I don't want a perfectly smooth glycam shot through everything. I want it to be have a little movement to it. And with the built-in image stabilization, you still have that organic feel, but it's not too much. I really like that. Now, this shot is with the 10 to 18.
Handheld.
Which I thought worked out great.
Mm-hmm. The tight shots, that's with the 85.
I like cutting back and forth. And then when they're dancing, that's with the 10 to 18 as well. And expose it just for the couple, which I thought...
I
love the exposure for this because they're exposed nicely. And you can see the horde of people around them. You see the silhouette of people in the background. Like, it just... people goes for miles is what it looks like. And I really like that. At this part of the horror... it was just, I love this part of it. It's just a very happy and just euphoric moment. While stand there getting the shot, I'll move my body forward and backward just to like push it a little bit and then pull out and just have a nice organic feel. But I wanted to get, this is one part of the wedding where you can get in tight and it's appropriate. I mean, it's appropriate to be on the dance floor dancing and always have a smile on your face and being a part of the day. So getting in there tight, you're getting the viewer in there tight and they're kind of experiencing that atmosphere. And you know, we kind of lean the camera forward and then when it comes back out, we bring it back. And it just makes a beautiful little segment. A lot of camera movement, which I think works well with this. I call it action-oriented dance floor. And we just have
more fun.
More fun. And then the night, the dancing ended with the bridal party on stage. Another Sony filmmaker getting some additional shots. And again, I love it. Mom and dad get out there and just act like they're 16 again.
We heard that dad was really sore afterwards.
Yeah, we heard that dad had to take some time to recover from that dance. We're still on 85 with this shot. So she just stepped back to the back of the dance floor to get a wider shot to encompass the bridal party. The end shot, we wanted something really big, really cinematic to culminate everything that had happened. So we chose a drone shot to show the dance floor and then to transition to the night skyline of Vegas.
We had such an amazing time creating Jenny and Michael's wedding film, and we absolutely love what we were able to come home with, and we know that Jenny, Michael, and their family do as well.
In this video, you have learned about the advantages of shooting in 4K.
Key features of Sony cameras and lenses.
How to create a strong wedding film intro.
You also learned about using time shift to help tell your story.
How to introduce characters in your video, such as the bride, groom, and their family.
Using the high dynamic range of Sony cameras for color grading.
Another thing you've learned about is using multiple cameras and different focal lengths for a variety of shots.
Being culturally aware for significant moments in a wedding day.
Using music to create powerful moments.
We really hope that this video shows you how we implement 4K on our wedding films and how it helps us tell a better story and deliver a superior product for our clients.
Thank you all so much for watching.
Thank you.
the end.